Hi, this presentation is going to provide an overview of measures of position. And we can begin that conversation with a look at perhaps a familiar term, the quartile, where we divide things into four equal parts and indicate the quartiles with these notations, Q1, Q2, and Q3. And Q1 corresponds to 25% of the distribution, Q2 to half, and Q3 to 3/4, or 75%. Then, of course, 100% would be Q4 if we wanted to include that. The next step is to find quartiles. So here's an example. The quiz scores of 15 students are listed here, and we want to find the first, second, and third quartiles. And in this case, we have to order the data from lowest to highest, then identify the lower half and the upper half. In this case, we have an odd number of cases. So there's one in the middle, and guess what that one is called? That's right, it's called the median, the middle value, as we saw. And we see that a quarter of the cases results in getting to 37, and on the other side, to 48. And after we've calculated quartiles, we can then come up with the interquartile range, which is simply Q3 minus Q1, the 75th minus the 25th percentile, which gives us the middle 50% of the distribution. So in this case, we had Q1 37, Q2 43, and Q3 48. We subtract 37 from 48, we get 11. So 11 is our interquartile range. The box and whisker plot gives us a visual of this, the quartiles and the interquartile range, where we have the Q1, Q2, Q3, the minimum and maximum entry. And here's what it looks like. Now the same values from before. 28 was the low and the high was 55. Our Q1 was 37, our median was 43, our Q3 was 48. So this is what it looks like when you set up a box and whisker plot with those values in mind. So quartiles are just one way to divide a distribution. There are other what we would call fractiles, which are just numbers that partition or divide an ordered data set. So we could talk about deciles if we were divided up by 10 instead of by 4, or quintiles if we did it by 5. The percentile is dividing an ordered data set into 100 parts. So that's something that we're all familiar with as we encounter percentiles quite often. And so usually if you see test scores, they can be sorted in this particular way. And we'll finish our discussion of measures of position by looking at one of the most important types, the standard score, or z-score, used in so many other types of statistics that we'll be doing. So this represents the number of standard deviations that a data value, x, falls from the mean. It gives us a sense of position relative to the mean there. So z is value minus mean over standard deviation. So for example, we have test scores from a statistics final at Union College with a mean of 78 and a standard deviation of 7. If we want to find the z-score for 85, 70, and 78, we then come over here and plug in those values, right? We got the mean of 78, and that's going to be the same. We have 7 scores, that's going to be the same. Sorry, it's to 7 was the standard deviation. That's going to be the same. And the values are the only thing that vary, so if we plug those in, we're going to get these z-scores. So the 85 is 1 standard deviation from the mean, 78 is the mean, so it's 0 standard deviations, and 70 is 1.14 away from the mean. If we were to calculate the z-scores for 2 students in the class and arrive at their z-scores, we could then assess the relative z-score. So John received a 75, the whole mean for the class was 73.2, the standard deviation was 4.5. Samantha got the 68.6, and her class mean was 65, the standard deviation of 3.9. So which student had the better score, even though there's different classes that they're in? We could see that John's score was 0.4 standard deviations higher than the mean, while Samantha's score was 0.92 higher than the mean, so Samantha's score was better in a relative sense.